Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So unit number 3, aperture and slot antennas. So far we have seen under unit number 1, fundamentals of radiation, basic antenna parameter, radiation from off a dipole, oscillating current element and a folded dipole. Under unit number 2, we went from single antenna element to antenna array. What is meant by an antenna array? The types of antenna array. Especially, we discussed two types of antenna array, broadside array and end fire array in detail. Then we went to binomial array and the phased array, antenna synthesis and principle of pattern multiplication. Finally, we completed unit number 2 with the topic Yagi-Uda antenna array. Now, unit number 3, we are going to come across two types of antenna. One is called aperture antenna, another one is called slot antenna. Aperture means opening. Aperture means opening. Slot, you know the meaning of a slot. So opening in a closed surface is called aperture. So the unit, third unit, is divided into two classification. One is aperture, another one is slot antenna. So the first half will deal with aperture antenna, the second half with the slot antenna. So we are going to see the topic, radiation from rectangular aperture, uniform and tapered aperture. If the opening is uniform, it is called uniform aperture. Tapered aperture means a part of the opening is available. You know the meaning of rectangular aperture. Then we are going to see about horn antenna, reflector antenna. Under reflector antenna, we are having a lot of types. Flat reflector antenna, corner reflector antenna, parasitic reflector antenna, then aperture blockage, feeding structure. We are going to see the antennas of types. Two antennas will be there. One is called the primary antenna, another one is called the secondary antenna. So the both the primary and the secondary put together is called reflector antenna. So one of the antenna is going to act as a feed, another antenna is going to act as a reflector. So in that case, it is called feeding structure. Slot antenna, there will be a reflecting surface, antenna reflecting surface will be available. Over the reflecting surface, a slot, maybe a circular slot or a rectangular slot or any type of slot will be available. That is called slot antenna. Then comes a microstrip antenna. It is also called patch antenna. We are coming across one type of antenna in the mobile phone, which is called microstrip antenna or patch antenna. It will be integrated into the IC device. Then radiation mechanism. There are different type of radiation mechanism available. Application. And there is a numerical tool for antenna analysis. We need to analyze the performance of an antenna using various software tools are available. We are going to see the list of software tool. So using the software tool, I will be able to analyze the performance of an antenna. Then I can go for design of an antenna because I know the output of the antenna. Then I go for the design of the antenna. I can use it for the suitable application and the suitable frequency. So these are the various topics under unit number 3. So basically, we come across two category of antenna. I cannot say type of antenna. We are coming across two category of antenna. One is called aperture antenna. The second one is called horn antenna. Now, before going to the syllabus topic, let me give an introduction to aperture antennas. Aperture antennas are most common at microwave frequency. If you say microwave frequency, it means it is greater than 300 megahertz. So at high frequency, aperture antennas are most commonly used. In general, aperture means opening. So aperture in the antenna means opening in a closed surface. Basically, the antenna will be a closed surface. That closed surface, if there is any opening, it is called aperture antenna. So there are different geometrical configuration for the aperture antenna. It may take the form of a waveguide or a horn, where aperture may be a square. You may have a square opening. You may have a rectangular opening, circular opening, elliptical opening, or any other configuration. Now have a look at figure number 1. So we are having here three types of aperture antenna configuration. One is called pyramidal horn antenna. So horn, this is called pyramidal horn antenna, conical horn antenna, rectangular waveguide antenna. So you know the meaning of waveguide. Horn. This is in the form of a pyramidal horn. Basically, this is a derivative from rectangular waveguide. Second one is conical horn. see the shape of the opening at the antenna. It is cylindrical in nature. This one rectangular, but probably it takes the shape of a pyramid. It is called pyramidal horn antenna, rectangular waveguide. So these are the openings available. So based upon the opening, we call it as aperture antenna, conical horn antenna, pyramidal horn antenna, a rectangular waveguide antenna. So likewise, we can have a lot of configuration on aperture antenna. So where we are using this aperture antenna application, you know, I told you the frequency, microwave frequency range, aperture antennas are useful. But practically where they are used means for the space application, because the flush mounted on the surface of the spacecraft or the aircraft. For example, a spacecraft or aircraft, a satellite is moving in the free space. So at that time, they will go for aperture antenna. Aperture antenna means opening in a closed surface. So generally, this opening will be covered with a dielectric material to protect them from the environmental condition. For example, you have a closed surface on the surface of the satellite in the free space, your opening will be available. That through the opening only, radiation of electromagnetic wave goes into the free space. But generally, this opening will not be left open all the time. It will be covered with a dielectric material. It will be covered with a dielectric material because in order to protect from the environmental condition. So whenever they operate for a transmission or reception, so at that time they will remove the dielectric material and the opening will be available for the free space or available for radiation or reception. But we will not be using separate antenna for transmitting and a separate antenna for receiving. One single antenna will be available on the surface of the satellite. Same antenna will be used for both the transmission and the reception. So in that case, this aperture antenna is used in the surface of the satellite. Generally, it will be closed with a dielectric material. Whenever required, they will remove the dielectric material and then the antenna will be available for either transmission or reception. So this type of mounting does not disturb the aerodynamic profile of the aircraft for high speed critical application. So whenever I cross the dielectric material over the opening of the satellite, over that close the surface of the satellite, I can use the satellite for high-speed application. So when I use the satellite for high-speed application, your opening in the antenna does not disturb the profile or working of the satellite. So this aperture antenna find suitable in the space application. The radiation character of a wire antenna can be determined once current distribution on the wire known. We have seen two topics under Unit 1. Radiation from an oscillating current element. Then radiation from a half-way dipole or quarter-way monopole. So in that case, how we are able to determine the radiation character means, first of all, we have to see the distribution of current over the antenna element. The current distribution over the antenna element, either oscillating current element or half-way dipole or quarter-way monopole. Then only we can determine the radiation character. What do you mean by radiation character? We want the expression for E suffix theta, E suffix R, H pi. E theta, E pi and H pi. So that is called radiation characteristics. So how do you determine the radiation characteristics means? First of all, you should determine the current distribution in the antenna element. Then only you can determine the radiation characteristics of wire antenna. This is applicable for aperture antenna also. But in the case of aperture antenna, the current distribution is not known exactly. Physical experimental measurement can provide a reasonable approximation. So as a case with the oscillating current element or either with a half-way dipole or a quarter-way monopole, I am able to determine the current distribution so that I can find the radiation characteristics also in a comfortable manner. But this is not the case with the aperture antenna. In the case of aperture antenna, the current distribution is not evaluated in an exact manner. We need to perform certain physical experimental measurements on that aperture antenna. Then only we are able to determine the radiation characteristics. So this is more evident in the aperture antenna. Whatever we discussed now, it is more applicable for the aperture antenna. So analysis, how do you analyze the aperture antenna? Conversion of original antenna geometry into an equivalent geometry, which can be looked at as radiation through an aperture in a closed surface. So how to determine the radiation character for an aperture antenna? I should convert original geometry. Original geometry means the original surface of the antenna or the original physical appearance of the antenna, it should be converted to an equivalent geometry. From the equivalent geometry only, I will be able to calculate the radiation characteristics in an easy manner. How to obtain this equivalence? To obtain the equivalence, we go for a principle known as field equivalence principle. The principle is called field equivalence principle or Huygens principle. Using this principle only, I will be converting the original geometry of the aperture antenna into an equivalent geometry. From the equivalent geometry, I will be able to calculate the radiation characteristics of the aperture antenna. Once it is known, we can analyze the antenna. We can conclude the performance of the antenna for a particular application. So one such principle is called field equivalence principle or Huygens principle. Let us see this principle now. Huygens principle state each point on a primary wavefront can be considered to be a new source of a secondary spherical wave, and that a secondary wavefront can be constructed as an envelope of this secondary spherical wave. So I will tell you the meaning of Huygens principle. The statement says that generally, if you have an antenna, radiation of electromagnetic wave will be there. In the radiation of the electromagnetic wave, there are two types of wavefront available. One is called the primary wavefront, another one is called the secondary wavefront. But you imagine there is a primary wavefront as well as a secondary wavefront. So each point on the primary wavefront, wavefront means the pattern, the radiation pattern of the electromagnetic wave in the near region. Secondary wavefront means it is in the far field region. So each point on the primary wavefront will act as a source for secondary spherical wave, and the collection of secondary spherical wave put together is called secondary wavefront. So in turn, I can say that very shortly, your primary wavefront is created by the antenna, your secondary wavefront is created by the primary wavefront in turn with each other. So such a principle is called Huygens principle or field equivalence principle. So by this principle, what we are going to do means we are going to replace the actual sources. What are our actual sources? One is called antenna, another one is called transmitter. So transmitter means energy generator, antenna means energy radiator. The difference between antenna and transmitter you must able to know clearly. Transmitter means energy generator, antenna means energy radiator. So your transmitter cannot generate energy and radiate into the free space directly. So for that, in the middle, we need an element called antenna. Antenna is nothing but a radiating element. So these two sources, antenna and transmitter, will be replaced by the equivalent sources. How will you replace the equivalent sources? By applying this Huygens principle or field equivalence principle, we will determine the radiation characteristics. So from the radiation characteristics, we can determine the performance of the aperture antenna. So by the equivalence principle, the field outside the imaginary closed surface obtained by placing over the closed surface suitable electric and magnetic field current density, which is satisfy the boundary condition. So I will have a closed surface. The closed surface means a spherical surface. The spherical coordinate system is nothing but an imaginary closed surface. So whatever field outside the closed surface only, we are bothered about that. Imagine that antenna is located at the center of the spherical coordinate system. We are going to determine the field outside the closed surface as we have saw in the unit number one, radiation from oscillating current element and radiation from alpha dipole. So likewise, we are by the equivalence principle, we are not bothered about the field inside the closed surface. So we are bothered about the field outside the closed surface by placing electric and magnetic field current density. So electric field density means J, current density. Magnetic field current density means M. So we are going to place J vector and the M vector inside the closed surface. We are going to determine the field outside the closed surface, which is satisfy the boundary condition. The equivalence principle is developed by considering an actual radiating source, which is electrically represented by J1 and M1 as shown in the figure. I will show the diagram. This one is the actual problem or actual source. This one is the equivalent problem or equivalent source. So from the actual problem or from the actual source, I am unable to find the radiated field outside. outside the closed surface. Your closed surface is nothing but a spherical coordinate system. You would have come across in unit number one. We are placing the antenna current element or half a dipole or a quarter wave monopole at the center of the spherical coordinate system, and we were able to find the expression for E suffix pi, E suffix theta, and H pi at the far field region. Similarly here, this is a closed surface, spherical coordinate system. The volume of the surface is V1. Outside the closed surface, the volume is V2. See, V2 is infinite in nature. You can see the diagram V2. V1 is finite. From the diagram, V1 is finite. How do you say is finite? We are having a dotted line. How do you say V2 is infinite? We don't have any limitation for V2. So V2 is infinite in nature. V1 is finite in nature. So within the closed surface, S is nothing but the surface integral. So within the closed surface, I am placing two sources, J1 and M1, corresponding to antenna and a transmitter. J1 corresponds to transmitter. M1 corresponds to antenna. So actual sources are replaced by J1 and M1. J1 current density, M1 magnetic field density. So we are having some field, original field. We are having here E1 and H1 within the closed surface. But we are bothered about the E1 and H1 outside the closed surface. That means I am not bothered about E1 and H1 within the closed surface. We are bothered about E1 and H1 outside the closed surface or in the volume integral V2. See the diagram V, equivalence problem or equivalent source. Your J1 and M1 is totally replaced. J1 and A1 is totally replaced or removed. We are having a magnetic field E and H within the closed surface, which we are not going to bother. So we are going to assume E and H, some value available within the closed surface, which we are not going to bother at all. But see the volume integral V2. Outside V2, we want to know the expression for E1 and H1. To know the value of E1 and H1, I need to know the value of J vector and M vector. Now J vector and M vector, the current density are available on the surface of the closed surface. They are available on the surface of the closed area in such a way that J equal to unit vector into H1 minus H vector. H vector available within the closed surface. E vector available within the closed surface. So we are substituting here and we are getting J vector and M vector. Because of J vector and M vector, I will be able to determine the value of E1 and H1 in the unit direction or in the vector direction given by n cap. This principle is called equivalent principle. I am replacing the actual setup by means of an equivalent setup. In the equivalent setup, if I am able to find the field outside the closed surface, that will be equivalent to the electric field given by the actual sources J1 and M1 within the closed surface. So this theorem or principle is called Huygens principle or field equivalence principle. This will be applied for analyzing the aperture antenna in the coming topic. This is actually the topic 1. I made it as topic 2, radiation from aperture field. That means radiation from aperture antenna. Your aperture antenna may be a rectangular aperture or circular aperture, maybe uniform in nature or tapered in nature. We are going to determine the radiation, means we are going to find out the expression for E vector and H vector for aperture antenna. The general coordinate system for aperture antenna analysis is shown in figure 2.5. The radiating field are determined by first finding the vector potential A and F from the surface current density J and M respectively. We have already got the expression for E theta, E pi and H pi under unit number 1 using vector potential AZ. In this case, we are having two vector potential. One is A, another one is F. A corresponds to J vector. F corresponds to M vector, where J vector is a current density, M vector is magnetic field density respectively. Now let us have a look at the diagram. Just have a look at the diagram for a minute. This one is a spherical coordinate system for aperture antenna analysis. I want to analyze the aperture antenna by writing down the expression for the electric field and the magnetic field in terms of vector potential A and F. A corresponds to J, F corresponds to M. J means current density, M means magnetic field density. They corresponds to E vector and H vector respectively. So that is a spherical coordinate system available in the diagram. In the center, you imagine that we are having an aperture antenna here. This aperture antenna, in the center we have the antenna element. We are having an aperture here, opening here at this point. At this junction, we are having an opening. So that opening is shown as a surface. Generally, we go for spherical coordinate system R, theta, and pi. With respect to small letter R, I'm having pi as well as theta. You can see that theta, pi. With respect to R dash, with respect to small letter R dash, we are having theta dash and pi dash and theta dash. This one is a surface. The opening and the surface corresponds to the aperture. This is having the coordinate x dash, y dash and z dash. Normally spherical coordinate system x, y, z, but on the surface I'm having x complement, y complement and z complement. R is a distant point somewhat in the far field. I'm going to analyze the aperture antenna in terms of E vector and H vector. So we are having here two types of spherical coordinate system, R theta comma pi, R dash comma theta dash comma pi dash. Then we are having the element capital letter R, distant point or far field evaluation. So from the far field evaluation, R equal to R minus R dash cos psi for the phase variation. So R is approximately, this symbol will indicate approximation. So R approximately equal to R minus R dash cos psi. But this is for the phase variation. If I include a phase angle into consideration, this will come into picture. But for the amplitude variation, R will be approximately equal to R. You can see the diagram. Capital letter R will be approximately equal to small letter R. Now the given vector potential A and F generated by the current density J and M is given by A vector potential A equal to mu by 4 pi surface integral J bar e power minus j kr divided by R ds bar, because we are doing the surface integral ds bar. This is equivalent to mu e power minus j kr small letter r divided by 4 pi r m, where m is nothing but this value. So already this value is available in the form of an integral m. So I'm replacing the integral by the value of m. I'm getting the vector potential in terms of permeability, radius r, as well as m. But a surface integral of current density. N is nothing but a constant, or n is nothing but a parameter or a variable, which corresponds to surface integral of J bar. Similarly, M. M is another vector potential corresponding to M. F is another vector potential corresponding to M. So here we are getting epsilon, permittivity, mu, permeability, e power minus j kr divided by 4 pi r L, where L equal to surface integral of magnetic field intensity M. So we are expressing A in terms of M, we are expressing F in terms of L. Then in the far field, I am going to evaluate E and H field are dominant. We don't have, whenever I go to the far field, see the diagram. Whenever I go to the far field, R value will not be available. R value becomes invalid, or R complement becomes invalid. Because whenever I go to the far field, we have only two angles. This we have already seen in the previous derivation also. Theta and pi only exist. Theta component and pi component of E and H field are dominant. R field will become zero. Or in other words, I can say that E suffix R equal to zero, H suffix R equal to zero. But we are having E with respect to A, E with respect to F. because we are having two vector potential. Since I am having two vector potential, I will be having two expressions for E in terms of A, two expressions for E in terms of theta and pi. You can see the E expression, theta expressions will be 2 in terms of A and F. Pi expression for E in terms of A and F. Similarly for H also. So minus j omega a theta, minus j omega a pi, minus j omega eta. Eta means permittivity of the free space. Sorry, eta means intrinsic impedance of the free space. So minus j omega eta f pi, minus j omega eta f theta. So similarly, we are having 4 + 4, 8 expressions are there. Because I am having 4 component here, theta component and pi component in terms of A and F for both E and H. So totally 8 components are available. And finally, I am substituting the value of A theta, substituting the value of A, substituting the value of F, N and L. N and L I am not substituting. I am substituting the value of A and N in this expression. Then I am getting the expression for E theta, E pi combined together. I am combining both equations with respect to L and N. So E theta, E pi, E r equal to 0. Because I was telling about the far field region. So H r equal to 0. When I combine L and N with respect to theta and pi, I will get an expression for H theta and H pi. So these are the final equation. These are the final equations for analysis of the aperture antenna. So under this topic, what we are doing means we are taking a spherical coordinate system. So in the spherical coordinate system, I'm locating the aperture antenna at the center of the spherical coordinate system. I have two types of spherical coordinate. One is r theta comma pi, because I'm having two vector potential A and F. I'm going to evaluate E bar and H bar at the far field due to the aperture antenna. So at a distance r dash, we are having a surface in the form of an aperture or opening that is having the coordinate x complement, y complement, and z complement. But compared to x, y, z of the spherical coordinate, I am writing down the expression for r equal to r. I am writing the expression for a bar and a vector potential a bar and f bar in terms of n and l. N is nothing but a constant corresponding to surface integral of j bar. L is another constant corresponding to surface integral of magnetic field density. Now we are going to write down the expression for theta and pi in terms of electric field for A bar and F bar separately. So we get 4 + 4, 8 components available. I'm substituting the value of A and F in this electric field and magnetic field expression, and I'm combining both A and F. When I combine both A and F, I will get one expression for E theta, one expression for E pi, and obviously ER and HR will be 0. Similarly, we get the expression for H theta and H pi. So far, two topics are over. So under the two topics, so we have seen that the Huygens principle or field Huygens principle. Using the principle, one actual problem will be converted to equivalent problem. So from the equivalent problem, we are able to determine the field for outside the volume integral or outside the closed surface. Thereby, aperture antenna analysis can be done very easily. And then we have taken an aperture antenna in a spherical coordinate system. We have got the expression for E theta, E pi, H theta, H pi in terms of two vector potential A and F with respect to L and N constant. And we have coming across ER equal to 0 and then H bar equal to 0. Now we have completed two topics. One topic is a Huygens principle or field Huygens principle. Second one is radiation from an aperture field. So any difficulty in these two topics, you can put it in the chat box. Any difficulty under unit number, topic number one and topic number two? One student was asking to explain the last slide. I want to evaluate under topic number 2, I want to evaluate the radiation field for E bar and H bar in the far field region for an aperture antenna. So whenever you want to do the radiation characteristics, we have to locate the aperture antenna at the center of a spherical coordinate system. And this system is nothing but an imaginary surface. So inside the imaginary surface, I am having two types of coordinate. The general coordinate are r, theta, comma, pi. But since this is an aperture antenna, we are having an aperture here or opening or a surface available. So we need to find r dash, theta dash, and pi dash. And at the far field region r, I am going to evaluate expression for E bar and H bar in terms of two vector potential A bar and F bar given. In our previous expression, we have come across only one alternating current element, one vector potential. So we are just constrained to r theta comma pi. But here we are given two vector potential A and F bar because we want to evaluate the expression for E bar and H bar in terms of vector potential A and F bar. And this one is an aperture antenna. So we are going to the far field region and evaluating E bar and H bar. Whenever I go to the far field region, the R value may not be available. Only theta and pi component will be available. So we have to find out the expression between R and R. In terms of phase variation, R equal to R minus R dash cos psi. But I stick to amplitude variation, R equal to R. Then I have the expression for A bar and F bar, two vector potential. In this vector potential, I'm replacing the surface integral of J bar by N. I'm replacing the surface integral of M by L. I'm substituting N and L in the expression for A bar and F bar. And I'm going for calculation of E bar in terms of theta and pi, in terms of theta and pi with respect to vector potential A. Similarly, evaluation of E bar with respect to theta and pi component in terms of vector potential F. Once it is evaluated, I'm doing the same thing for a magnetic field. So totally we are having 4 plus 4, 8 components are available. So from the above equation, these are the equations A and F. I'm substituting the value of A and F here. Then I'm combining the components with respect to theta in one equation, pi in one equation. So I'm able to get E theta and E pi. You need not show the mathematical simplification as well as derivation for E theta and E pi. Directly you can come and substitute. Derivation is required only under unit number 1 and 2. As far as unit number 3 is concerned, we are much bothered about only the resultant equation. So do not worry about the derivation or the course of derivation for the given equation. So what we are doing means we are substituting the value of A theta, A pi, F theta and F phi from the equation 2.21 to 2.24. Once these equations are substituted, I am combining theta component with respect to A and F in one equation called electric field E theta in terms of L and N. Because L corresponds to F, N corresponds to J. N corresponds to A, L corresponds to F. So I'm combining both the component in terms of E theta, similarly for E pi, and obviously ER equal to 0. Same thing I'm writing for the magnetic field component also. Once these equations are available, radiation characteristics can be easily evaluated or can be determined for the aperture antenna. By this, we are analyzing the performance of an aperture antenna before going to design of aperture antenna. So these two topics tell about how to determine the analysis of an aperture antenna by applying the field Huygens principle or Huygens principle or field equivalence principle. Let us go to topic number 3, radiation from rectangular aperture. Actually, this is the first topic from unit number 3. You can see it here, radiation from rectangular aperture. So far, I gave an introduction to aperture antenna, then field equivalence principle, then radiation from aperture field. All those information will give an idea about aperture antenna. Now only we are entering into the surface radiation from rectangular aperture. So topic three, this is supposed to be the topic one, radiation from rectangular aperture antenna. Actually, it should be radiation from rectangular aperture antenna. Have a look at the diagram for a minute. There is a rectangular aperture antenna available in the figure. So in the figure, we come across a spherical coordinate system. This total spherical coordinate system is available in the The total antenna setup is available in the XY plane. Even though this spherical coordinate system is having three coordinate X, Y, and Z, the total setup, the antenna arrangement is available only in the XY plane. So what do you mean by infinite electric ground plane? This one is the infinite electric ground plane. It is shown it here as an infinite ground plane. Ground plane means ground surface. You imagine a ground surface which is infinite in nature. Over the ground plane, I am placing a rectangular aperture. I'm having a surface, I'm having a closed surface. So in the closed surface, I'm having an opening in the form of a rectangular. That is why it is called rectangular aperture antenna. So an infinite ground surface is available, or a ground plane. Over that, I'm having a closed surface. Where is your closed surface? Your shading is a closed surface. What is this one? This one is nothing but an infinite ground plane. We are having a closed surface in the form of a shading. A blue color shading is available. And there is an opening over the closed surface. But how does the opening look like? You can see the opening looks like a rectangular. And that is why it is called rectangular aperture antenna. So whenever you have an opening over in the closed surface, so what is the dimension of the opening? A, length of the aperture. B, breadth of the aperture. We are locating this one act as an antenna. This opening act as an antenna. So we are locating the Z axis here, but the total setup is available in the XY plane. I am going expression for E bar and H bar at a distant point R, and this angle is nothing but theta. This angle is nothing but pi dash. So we are going to evaluate the expression for E bar and H bar at the distant point R, and this opening is in the form of a rectangular. That is why it is called rectangular aperture antenna. Consider that a rectangular aperture is mounted on an infinite ground plane, assuming the field to be constant, and we are assuming the total field over the opening to be a constant one. That is, in the near field region, it is constant. Within the opening, it is constant. But we are going to evaluate the field only at a far field region. The constant electric field is given by E equal to A suffix y cap into E naught. Why E naught means the electric field is going to be uniform over the opening. Where X bar lies between minus A by 2 to A by 2 plus A by 2. Y bar lies between minus B by 2 and plus B by 2. So we are having your A bar and X bar from the diagram. A is nothing but the length of the opening. B is nothing but the breadth of the opening. And X bar but the you can see from the diagram X bar and Y bar. X bar and Y bar, derivative of X and Y. The total setup is available in the XY plane. We are having an expression for the constant field. E suffix A in terms of A suffix Y cap E naught. So there is a constant uniform field available over the aperture opening. Our problem, our objective is to find the expression at the far field with respect to the aperture opening. to obtain the equivalent of this situation. Now the aperture antenna is available. We have to find the equivalents. How do you find the equivalents? You have to apply field equivalence principle. Assuming a closed surface extending between minus infinity to plus infinity on the xy plane, we can write two current density, magnetic field density and current density in terms of minus 2a z cap into a cap, a suffix y cap into e naught. So we are getting an expression here, current density equal to zero. We are able to get only the magnetic field density. So a suffix z cap into 2 e naught, where e naught is nothing but the uniform electric field available. So we are getting an expression for the magnetic field intensity. The far field radiated by the aperture can be found by using equation 2.27. 2.27, 2.28 and 2.29. 2.27 we are obtaining from here. These are the equations for 2.27. So we are going to apply the equation there. This one is the general expression for an aperture field. Now we are going to apply that expression for the rectangular aperture antenna. So when I apply that, I am able, when I substitute j equal to 0, I will get n theta equal to n pi equal to 0. We will get the expression for L, because L in terms of M. And equation 2.31 get reduced to L theta equal to 2ab e theta cos phi sin x by x sin y by y, where x and y is given in terms of k theta and pi. Similarly, we'll get expression for L pi. Once these are available, we are able to get the expression for e theta and e pi. You remember that e theta and e pi, we are having both L and M. I will go to that equation. You see e theta and e pi, h theta and a pi, h pi, we are having both L and M. But since we are having n equal to 0, that is n theta equal to 0, n pi equal to 0, this portion will become 0. Here also this portion will become 0. Why n equal to 0? Because our current density j equal to 0. We are having current density j equal to 0. We are having only the magnetic field intensity value in terms of E naught. So n value will become 0. L theta and L pi will be available. N theta, n pi equal to 0. We are having only L theta and L pi. So this L theta and L pi, we are substituting in the place of e power j theta z equal to e power alpha z equal to sine alpha by 2c divided by alpha by 2c. When I substitute and do some manipulation, L theta, this equation will become this one, where x and y values are given. Similarly, L pi will become this one. When I substitute in the equation in the previous topic, I will get e theta equal to this one, e pi equal to this one, and h theta and h pi will get only the constant value. We are representing in terms of e theta, because according to Maxwell equation, magnetic field equal to electric field divided by eta, interscenic impedance. So whenever you are able to find the value for e theta and e pi, it is easy to calculate h theta and h pi, where er and hr equal to 0. When I substitute pi equal to pi by 2 in the E plane, those equations get reduced to E theta, ER and E pi. When I substitute pi equal to 0 in the H plane, they get reduced to this equation. So let me come from the beginning. We have already got equations for E theta, E pi, H theta, H pi, ER and HR equal to 0, generally for an aperture antenna. How did we get this equation? By applying Huygens principle or field equivalence principle, we are able to convert the original antenna into an equivalent problem. So from the equivalent problem, we are able to determine ER, E theta, E pi, HR, H theta, H pi, generally for an aperture antenna. But I want to evaluate for radiation field for a rectangular aperture. So when I go for a rectangular aperture, some of the parameters are getting reduced. So what are the parameters getting reduced? Current density equal to zero. But in the general expression, we have both the current density as well as magnetic field intensity. But in the case of rectangular aperture, current density becomes zero because of the setup. XY plane only available. Z equal to zero. And we have the expression for the magnetic field alone. Whenever J becomes zero, N theta, N pi becomes zero. Similarly, your equation L theta and L pi getting reduced. When I substitute this integral value into that equation, I get a final equation for L theta as well as L pi. I'm substituting this value in the previous value, in the previous topic value. So I get E theta and E pi, ER equal to zero, HR equal to zero. I'm not substituting this value for H theta and H pi. Generally, I'm writing H theta equal to minus E pi by eta, H pi equal to plus E theta by eta. By that, we are able to get the equation for a rectangular aperture antenna. This is specifically for a rectangular aperture antenna, but the previous one is for any aperture antenna, maybe a rectangular or circular or any shape, it can be assumed. Now, under rectangular aperture, we come across two topics. One is called tapered aperture. We have previously come across uniform aperture. Uniform means the total surface is uniform with A and B dimension. But here, we don't have a uniform tapered aperture. That means this is also rectangular in nature, but you can see that dimension. The dimension B is very smaller when compared to A. So this portion is called tapered aperture antenna. So we have to see the radiation field, either E bar and H bar for tapered aperture. Have a look at the diagram for a minute. In this figure, we are having a tapered aperture. So there is a closed surface available. Only a part of the surface is used. That is why it is called tapered aperture. See the previous diagram. We are using a majority portion. We are using a majority portion of the closed surface as an aperture. That is why it is called uniform aperture with a dimension A and B. But have a look at this diagram. This one is the closed surface of the antenna, but only a portion of the antenna is tapered as an opening. Tapered means created as an opening. That is why it is called tapered aperture. The dimensions are A and B. A, length of the antenna. B, breadth of the antenna. We are having the spherical coordinate system x, y, z plane. This one looks like a rectangular waveguide. You would have come across a transmission line waveguide in the previous semester. So under waveguide, we are having two types. One is the rectangular waveguide, another one is circular waveguide. There are a number of propagation modes available in the rectangular waveguide. But the dominant mode, I hope you have come across the word dominant mode and rectangular in waveguide. TE10 mode is the dominant mode in the rectangular waveguide. That means this one is the efficient mode by which propagation can be done in an efficient manner. Propagation of electromagnetic wave. TE10 mode is the dominant mode in the rectangular waveguide. So we are applying the dominant mode here. We are using a portion of the close the surface of the antenna available. That is why it is called tapered aperture. We have obtained the equation for general aperture antenna. We already obtained the equation for rectangular aperture antenna in terms of E theta, E pi, ER, HR, H theta and H pi. Now we are going to get the equation, those equations for tapered aperture. So when I apply the tapered aperture and dominant mode TE10 mode, we are getting the equation as E suffix A equal to A suffix Y, because we are having the direction of electric field in this direction, E naught into cos of pi by A X complement, where X complement equal to minus A by 2 to plus A by 2, Y complement equal to minus B by 2 to plus B by 2. So our electric field, uniform electric field varies. See, in the previous case, A suffix Y cap into E naught. But here, But we are coming across E naught into cos of pi by A x dash in the y direction. Again, current density equal to zero. To obtain the equivalence of the situation, we cannot directly find the radiation characteristics of an aperture antenna directly. We have to go for the equivalent problem or equivalent principle. A closed surface extending from minus infinity to plus infinity on the xy plane. And now we are writing magnetic field intensity equal to minus 2 n cap into E naught. And that too only for this dimension. Otherwise it equal to zero. Current density equal to zero. So similarly, the fields are computed as ER, HR equal to zero. And E theta equal to minus pi by 2c sin pi cos x sin y divided by x square minus pi by 2 the whole square y. This x and y values are given in the previous expression. You can see the x and value. X equal to ka by 2 sin theta cos pi. Y equal to kb by 2 sin theta sin pi. You know the values theta and pi. And a and b correspond to dimensions of the given aperture antenna. So we are able to get e theta and e pi. To try to remember this equation for e theta and e pi, directly you can substitute for h pi and h theta. So when you compute for h theta, you will get e pi. When you compute for h pi, you will get e theta. By which we are able to get the expression for electric field and magnetic field in the far field region, both for uniform aperture and apart aperture. In the case of rectangular aperture antenna, so rectangular aperture antenna, we are having two classification. One is uniform aperture antenna, another one is tapered aperture antenna. You take down the equation for the electric field, constant electric field available in the uniform aperture and the tapered aperture. In terms of uniform electric field available over the opening, from that you try to find out the expression for m bar and j bar. Generally j bar equal to zero. When j bar equal to zero, n theta n pi equal to zero, we are able to compute the value of m. So from m, we are able to compute the value of l theta and l pi. From l theta and l pi, try to compute the value of e theta and e pi. Always er equal to zero, hr equal to zero. When you know the value of e theta and e pi, you can directly compute the value of h theta and h pi in terms of e pi, in terms of e theta, respectively. Similarly, you go for the tapered aperture also. So we are having two type of expression. One is for uniform aperture antenna, another one is for a tapered aperture antenna, by which radiation from rectangular aperture will be over. Let me go to topic 4, slot antenna. So I'm going to conclude the lecture with the topic 4, slot antenna. Introduction to slot antenna. Before going to the introduction, have a look at this diagram. Look at this diagram. This diagram indicates there is a slot antenna available. First of all, take a metallic conducting sheet. This one is the metallic conducting sheet, and this one is said to be the antenna closed surface. And there is an opening here. This opening is nothing, whenever I create an opening, slot. It is called a slot. Our opening means it is called an aperture, but when I keep the corresponding surface beside, it is said to be slot antenna. The total setup is said to be slot antenna. This flat strip has been removed from the metallic conducting strip. So there is an infinite conducting sheet available. This one is Z, and this is Y direction, and this is X direction. Either we can feed the signal to the antenna through a transmission line, either you can feed it through a transmission line here or backside of the metallic conducting sheet. I am removing a flat strip equivalent to lambda by 2 distance. I am keeping it away on the right hand side, flat strip. When I fix the flat strip, it becomes a metallic conducting sheet. When I remove them, this becomes a slot antenna. When I remove them, this becomes a slot antenna. These two are complementary to each other. These two are complementary to each other. What do you mean by complementary to each other? For example, if a person keeps on talking for a longer time, the complementary activity to be done is he has to go for silence. If a person is not at all working for a very longer period, the complementary work is he has to go for working. Suppose if a person is working for a very longer period, the complementary work is he has to take rest. If you are taking rest for a very longer period, you have to work. That is called complementary work. Or if you are working for a very longer period, means you have to take rest, complementary work. If you are speaking for a very longer period, the complementary work is you have to go for the silence activity. Or you are silent for a very longer activity, you have to go for the speaking. Likewise, we are having two complementary activity here. This one is a slot antenna and this one is a flat strip antenna. We call it as a dipole antenna. Why we call it as a dipole antenna? It is having two poles here. This is one pole, this one is another pole. Lambda by 2. When I join them, it becomes a metallic conducting sheet. It is not having any meaning for an antenna. When I create a slot, when I create an aperture, this total setup becomes an antenna. This antenna is called slot antenna. Slot antenna is a radiating element formed by a slot in a metallic surface. Here, this one is a metallic surface. I'm creating a slot here and opening cut in a conducting sheet or in one of the walls of the waveguide act as an antenna. This is a metallic conducting sheet. Even you can create an opening in a waveguide, that also becomes a slot antenna. Generally, the slot antenna excited either by a coaxial cable or through a waveguide. Either you can go for a coaxial transmission line or a waveguide to excite. Excite means to give the signal. To give the signal to a slot antenna, either you can go for a coaxial cable or a waveguide. The slot antenna is the best suitable radiator for the frequency above 200 MHz. Now the range of frequency is mainly required for the slot antenna. So at what type of frequency we can go for the slot antenna means you can use the slot antenna for frequency greater than 200 MHz. Now consider an infinite conducting sheet shown in the figure. This one is the infinite conducting sheet available in the figure. I'm just making a cut here. Opening, I'm keeping it aside. Now this one becomes an antenna. If I don't want the antenna setup means you take the flat strip, fix it in the original place. Now it becomes an ordinary metallic conducting sheet. It won't act as an antenna. So if I remove a flat metallic strip away from the metallic conducting sheet, this setup becomes an antenna, which is called a slot antenna. We get the complete original infinite conducting sheet. Hence, the infinite conducting sheet with the slot and the flat strip are said to be complementary. I told you the complementary, the meaning of complementary. So here, when I join together, we get a ordinary metallic conducting sheet. When I remove it, this becomes a slot antenna. And this one becomes a complementary antenna to slot antenna. And this slot lambda by 2 cut we have made. So this one is called lambda by 2 antenna. And this one is called slot antenna. Working principle of slot antenna. Whenever high frequency field exists across the narrow slot and infinite conducting sheet, the energy will be radiated through the slot. This is the working principle of slot antenna. So I am going to place an electric field across the slot. How do you place electric field across a slot? For a coaxial transmission line, go for a waveguide by which we can place the electric field across the slot. When you place an electric field across the slot, it will start radiating the electromagnetic energy into the free space. As the antenna is fed with the transmission line, the slot will radiate due to the current in the conducting sheet. The complementary of the slot antenna is the dipole shown in figure. So I told you this one is a complementary antenna. This one is a slot antenna. This is complementary. But how do this complementary and slot antenna work? You can see it here. Again, infinite conducting sheet is available. we have a flat conducting strip is available here. You can see the radiation pattern, figure of 8, vertical is available. And this one is the feed, A and B is the feed point, feed system by which we are able to feed the signal. And the signal is fed into the slot, field button will be available over the slot. You can see the field button here. A figure of 8 radiation curtain is available, but it is in vertical in nature. But see the field curtain in the dipole antenna. It is in the form of horizontal. But here also, I'm getting the same a figure of 8 shape, but this one is available in the horizontal direction. But here it is available in the vertical direction. So I was telling previously, this slot antenna and the dipole antenna are complementary to each other. If you are able to get the field pattern in an horizontal manner, you'll be able to get the field pattern in a vertical manner. But actually, it is available in a vertical manner in the slot antenna. So we are able to get the field pattern in a horizontal manner in the dipole antenna. Both are complementary to each other. When I combine them, it becomes an ordinary conducting shape. When I separate them, one becomes a slot antenna, another becomes the dipole antenna, which are complementary to each other. And the impedance values are given here. The terminal impedance of the slot is ZS, and the terminal impedance of the ZT, I am multiplying. When I multiply, I will get interscenic impedance. Interscenic impedance of free space is 277 ohms. So eta square divided by 4, 277 square by 2. Actually, ZS equal to eta by 2. So when I multiply means, I will get 277 square by 4. So we'll get the total impedance setup of the antenna arrangement equal to 25,476 ohms divided by ZD. Now slot antenna versus complementary antenna. We have to compare both the slot antenna and the dipole antenna. You can see the polarization is different in both the antenna. So we are able to see the vertical polarization in the slot antenna, horizontal polarization in the dipole antenna. So there is a difference in the polarization. If the polarization is horizontal in the slot antenna, it will be vertical in the complementary antenna. And the radiation from the backside of the slot antenna and the complementary antenna are also opposite polarity. So we have seen the, now let me conclude the lecture from the beginning. Today we have seen introduction to aperture antenna, then field equivalence principle or Huygens principle, radiation from aperture antennas in general, radiation from rectangular aperture antenna with respect to two category, uniform aperture antenna and tapered aperture antenna. Then we went to slot antenna. So slot antenna frequency greater than 200 megahertz and infinite conducting metal sheet. We are making a slot or opening on the surface. We'll make a dipole antenna. A dipole antenna, slot antenna, are complementary to each other. Here vertical polarization means here horizontal polarization will be available. When you combine them, you will get an infinite conducting sheet, which is no more use for radiating any element. When you separate them only, you will have two antenna which are complementary to each other. So we have come across today's class, rectangular aperture antenna in detail, and a brief introduction about slot antenna. So we have to see what all type of feeding method can be used for the slot antenna in the next class, that is tomorrow's class. So any difficulty in today's, any clarification required, this topic, rectangular aperture antennas and slot antenna. Shall we conclude the lecture, end the lecture, Ganesh?
Yes, sir.
Okay.